I'm going to talk more about the commercial aspects of the nanotechnology, and Ajay Sood was talked about the scientific part already earlier in the morning, which some of you might have attended this lecture. But anyway, I'll just briefly tell about the nano mission of Government of India, which is the reason why both of us are here, and then give examples of how commercialization of nanotechnology has taken place in India with a particular reference to my own laboratory, because we have done a lot of work in that area. First, the nano mission of the Government of India was launched in May 2007, and initial allocation was of 1,000 crores, which is about 200 million US dollars over 5 years. And the council, if you look at, has the structure as follows. The Nano Mission Council is chaired by Professor C.N.R. Rao, whom many of you know. And there are two parts to this council. One is the Nano Science and Advisory Group, which is chaired by Professor Sood, who is here. And the Nano Applications and Technology Advisory Group, which is chaired by me. And I will talk briefly about Nano Mission, but more about the Nano Applications and Technology Advisory Group, what we are doing, and then give examples of the technologies we have developed at ARCI. See, Nano Mission has done the last 3 years. What it has achieved is sort of given here. One is basically setting up of new dedicated institutes. Initially, we talked about 5 institutes, but only 2 are now being set up in the immediate future. One is already approved and is being set up in Mohali in Chandigarh, which is sort of west of Delhi. And the second center is going to be set up in Bangalore, along with the Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Scientific Research, which is in Bangalore also. But major funding from the Nano Mission has gone to creation of centers and units in existing universities and existing research institutions all over India. And more than 20 of them have been created. In all the major institutes and universities of excellence in India have received this funding. And this funding is quite large, and it's always towards the equipment, because of the salaries and the other incidental expenses are already borne by the labs of the universities. And this has been towards creation of facilities which are related to carrying out research in the area of nanoscience and technology. Then in terms of human resource development, the Nano Mission has also approved the conducting the master's course in the area of nanoscience and technology, specifically in the area of nanoscience and technology in 15 institutions. Half of them are private and half of them are government universities. And there are about 15 to 20 students in each program. So we are looking at about 300, maybe maximum number of students going through these master's programs in various institutes all over India. And the Nano Mission has funded these institutions to set up the laboratories, the nanotechnology laboratories for the purpose of teaching the students these areas, this part of the science. Then postdoctoral program also is there, where on a need basis we have, the Nano Mission has given approval for postdoctoral fellows, and that is also part of the human resource development. And then we also have set up a Center for Knowledge Management of Nanoscience and Technology, which comes out with a newsletter every 3 months. In fact, the first issue is already out. In fact, I'll give Professor Kati a copy. I forgot to give it to you in the morning. I'll do that. And this talks on not only about the status of Nano Mission projects in India, it reviews them on a regular basis, but also it looks at what is the status of nanotechnology and nanoscience all over the world. In fact, it gives information on the latest developments in the area of nanotechnology, which is of interest to the Indian institutions. And this is again contribution from the Nano Mission program. And then we also have international collaborations. Of course, Indo-Canada we are already talking about, which I think Professor Kati told you about what it is all about. We also have a collaboration with Rusnano in Russia, where we are looking at actually commercialization of nanotechnologies. This is only for the purpose of commercialization, because Rusnano has a mandate similar to what the part of the Nano Mission which I am chairing has. And they are looking at commercializing nanotechnologies in Russia, whereas we are looking at commercializing nanotechnologies in India. And as a result of this collaboration, what we plan to do is some of the Russian developments in science can be commercialized in India, or whatever is developed in India can be commercialized in Russia. So this cross-fertilization of the ideas is what we are looking at under this program. Indo-Australia also has a program we have started a program in the nanotechnology, and that is more of science-based, where we have collaborative research programs, more than anything else. Other thing which we have done as a part of this nano mission is to look at use of neutron and synchrotron radiation sources from various synchrotron and neutron centers in other parts of the world. Basically, we have, in particular, we have collaboration with KEK in Japan and also Petra and at DESY Germany. So in this program, what or any scientist in India or any scientist or faculty in India can get the beam time in these places, and the government, DST basically pays for the beam time as well as for the person to go by air to that place and come back, and also for the local hospitality. Everything is paid by DST, so they can just go and do the experiments there. Now I think apart from the nanoscience part of it, as I said, we also have a nano application technology development program, and I'll just briefly tell you what we have in mind in this program because it's just started. Unlike the nanoscience program, we had to go through a lot of formalities before we can start the program, because we have in mind some amount of grant to the industries as a part of this program, and some of the Indian government's mindset is not favorable towards giving grants to industries. They're ready to give grants to academic institutions and R&D labs, but not to industries. So we had to work through that, and also we had to involve a banker, financial institution, because when we give a loan, because it's going to be grant come loan, when we give a loan, the procedures have to be followed is not clear to departments like DST. So we wanted the financial institutions to be part of it. All that has been tied up now, and we are now going to advertise this program in a big way so that we have some encouraging results over the next 2 years. So the first is the technopreneurship development program, where we are looking at a scientist, engineer, faculty or graduate student having an idea developed at a lab scale in broadly in the area of nanoscience and technology. And suppose he thinks there's a commercial venture can be made out of this idea successfully, then we'll provide him a grant, and only for the purpose of proof of concept, which he can do in the lab itself or in the institute itself. So this is the money provided to him as a grant, and we hope at the end of the 6 months or 1 year, it can't be too long, he'll come with either a proof of concept or it'll be not considered as successful. Then we can also look at startup companies for specific commercial product, processes, and services. Again, we can look, here what we are looking at is either a CTO or CEO who is very familiar with the technology himself should be part of the program. And then in that case, the company can be given either a grant up to $100,000, I'll talk about it later, or plus a loan also, which is very low, which is almost zero interest loan, up to almost $2 million. So I'll talk about that later. This is the other program we have. And then we also have a program where, you see, the industry wants a certain product to be developed, and it wants the academic and R&D institution to do all the work in terms of development of the product. And in this case also, we can give a loan to the academic institution with industry contributing only 25% of the total cost of the project. The 75% will be given by DST to the academic institution so that the product is developed. And then industry on its own wants to develop a nanotechnology related product or process. Again, they can get up to 50% of the total project cost as a loan. This is the tables. I will not get into the details. Anyway, a hard copy and a soft copy is already with Professor Karti. Anybody is interested can look at it. But this, we are almost India-centric, of course. But the only thing I want to tell where the Canada part can come in is, suppose there are about, I think, almost close to 100 companies in Canada in the area of nanotechnology, all startup companies. And suppose some of the technologies, in fact, we have looked at some of those technologies already. Some of them are very, very relevant to India, and maybe the market size in India is much larger than what is available in Canada. In those cases, if the company, in the startup company in India, is in Canada is interested in going beyond Canada to India, and then we can find a partner, industrial partner for that company, and they can set up a joint venture in Canada, and we can fund the company, Indian part of the company, the joint partner with soft loans and some grants and all that. So that's what we are looking at as far as Canada-India collaboration is concerned. Otherwise, all other schemes are basically meant for Indian companies and Indian entrepreneurs. Now, what are some programs already ongoing in the area of where the industry gets the research work predominantly done at the academic institute and pays 20 to 25% of the project cost? We have five programs in this category. And if you look at the there are very interesting areas if you look at them. One is with IIT Madras and Carbendrum Universal, which is a company in Chennai also. And here, the Carbendrum Universal is looking at abrasive wheels for grinding operations of various materials. And what IIT Madras is supposed to develop is do nano alumina, nano silicon carbide, nano boron nitride, sorry, nano boron carbide in the form of this tips, which then can be attached to the abrasive wheel and the performance can be improved. So what we are hoping is that use of nano structured alumina, silicon carbide or boron nitride or carbide, because of the higher strength and also because of the expected higher toughness, will perform much better than the current material. Then University of Hyderabad has combined with Reddy's Lab, which is basically a pharmaceutical company which also does a lot of drug discovery for basically not only for development of nanotechnology drugs but also for drug deliveries. This is another project which is going on. Another project is IIT Delhi with about 5 textile companies. What we are trying to do is develop smart and interactive textiles. And one example is where we can do a silver coating on the silver nanoparticles can be coated on the fiber of the textiles, and that gives you antibacterial performance. Or we can do nano titania to get easy to clean, or we can do even fire retardant textiles. And also it's possible to have capsules incorporated in the textiles, which are called phase change materials, which allows you to use the same. The cloth becomes insulating during winter and becomes breathable during summer. So that also is another advantage of this. So this is all under development, and at least one product has already gone to the industry, as I'll tell you, in the case of ARCI. And this is another product which is again in the drug area, between an institute which deals with pharmacy in India, which is in Chandigarh, and Nicholas Pharma, which is a company in Bombay. And then we also have rubber technology, where we are looking at, instead of carbon black, using some other nanoparticles as the additive to the tires. Because the basic disadvantage with carbon black is that it is not fire retardant, and we hope to add some nanosilica and some other additives which can improve the performance of the tire, especially with regard to fire retardancy. Now basically I'll briefly tell about what we are doing at ARCI. Few words about ARCI. ARCI is a Autonomous R&D Institute, Department of Science and Technology in Hyderabad. We are about 160 scientists are employed here, and the average is about 38 years. But the main uniqueness about ARCI is the mandate itself. We are supposed to develop high performance materials and processes for niche market, which is not unusual. But more important is, unusual is demonstration of technologies at pilot scale or prototype scale, then transfer of technologies to the Indian industry. So our main mandate is to not only develop the process or the technology at the lab scale, but then go beyond and demonstrate it in an upscale version, and then make sure it works long enough for its reliability, consistency, and cost effectiveness to be proven. Then once it's done, it's transferred to the industry, maybe to one industry, in some cases a number of industries. That's what we have done very successfully in the last 8 years. About 30 technologies have been transferred. But those are all not all in this area of nanotechnology. Some of them only, or few of them, the last few years only we have worked on nanotechnology. Only a few projects, few technologies have been transferred to the industry in nanomaterials, and that I'll talk about. Other technologies are mostly in the area of coatings or ceramics or in the area of fuel cells. So these are the areas. In fact, ARCI is not only working on nanomaterials but a variety of areas all related to materials. So apart from nanomaterials, we will work on laser processing of materials, engineered coatings, which has been very successful. In fact, we have transferred these technologies to a large number of companies, and this center has earned more than what we have spent on them. Same is true for the ceramics processing area also, where we have done very well in terms of revenue generation, and laser processing also has done quite well. Sol gel coatings, which is a recent setup, it is getting into business of transferring technologies, just started. As of now, we have invested quite a bit of money, but we are yet to get returns on this. Fuel cell technology is set up in Chennai. Unlike the other centers which are in Hyderabad, this is in Chennai, and this is supposed to develop the PEM fuel cell. We have developed up to 10 kilowatt fuel cell, and it's being demonstrated for chloralkali plant, 25 kilowatt we are setting up, and also with Mahindra, we are setting up a small van with the fuel cell hybrid vehicle. We have a lot of facilities. I'll not get into the details because of lack of time. So we have almost all the facilities you can think of to make the nanomaterials. This is only the facilities for nanomaterials center I am talking about. Of course, some generic facilities are there, but apart from that, these are the facilities available in the nanomaterials center. Of course, other centers have also equally impressive facilities. But main thing I want to tell you is we have a large number of technologies for making nanopowders, because what we said was whatever technologies available in the world, we should have one of that, so that we can make and compare all these processes and decide which one is better for a given application. And many of these processes will give you powders in large quantities, unlike in grams, it will be in kilogram quantities. And that's what we want, because we want to do application development, and that requires large amount of powders. And we also have some facilities for carbon nanotubes, and also for graphene, and also for electrospinning to get nanofibers. And the powders, nanopowders, we can either convert it to bulk components using specialized sintering facilities like spark plasma sintering or microwave sintering or rate control sintering, or we can convert it to coatings, again using specialized coatings like detonation spray and cold spray and solution precursor spray, where we are able to retain the nanostructure even after the coating process. And we also have some other coating technologies where we can do nanomaterials right from the bulk, like pulse electrode deposition, or from super hard nanocomposites using the physical vapor deposition technology. And we have excellent facilities, as I said, for characterization of the materials. This I will not get into the details, but these are the different routes we get into making different products. I think it's, I'll leave it at that. So what are the programs we have with industries? In fact, initially when we started this nanomaterials program, we assumed that industries will not be interested. It will take a long time before industries come in and we start doing developing technologies and transferring it. But surprisingly, it was not the case. A lot of industries came in. I'll talk about some of these technologies as we go on as examples, but this gives you a total list of what we are doing currently with industries. And also, these are the programs which we have based on our own understanding of the Indian market. We find that some of them are very important for the industry. So we are already developing these things also on our own. And if the technology is developed successfully, then we'll look at how to transfer and whom to transfer. So these are all in-house projects which will ultimately look at applications. So we always look at development of anything with certain application in mind. It need not be immediate, it can be long range, but it has to be always towards an application which is very important for us. The first example is the nanocellular based ceramic candles for water filtration. This is an interesting product which came about because the DST was telling us that you have to contribute to the rural India also, because you just cannot do for the urban market. So look at some, and water is a major problem in India, where drinkable water or potable water is not available readily in many places, in many villages. So, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with this simple filter, which used to be, which is still popular in India, where you have two containers at the bottom and the top, and these are the ceramic candles which are put inside on the top one, and the water is poured on the top, and it goes through that candle through a tortuous path, and as it comes out, the water is collected here. In a simple candle, as it was available 1 year back, this candle can remove only the suspended particles, really, nothing else. But the bacteria is not removed. So you get suspension-free water, but still not bacteria-free. So what we have done is, we have developed a patented process by which we can coat all the pores of this candle with nano-silver. And based on that, we are able to develop the process. And once we do that, we get not only suspension-free water, but also bacteria-free water. The advantage is this for the rural area is twofold. One is no electricity is required, because you know electricity is highly unreliable in this rural areas. And more important, you don't require even piped water. You can take it in your vessel and pour it on the top and get the bacteria-free water. This, we went through a lot of field tests. We supplied about 60 villages all over Andhra Pradesh for 1 year. They kept checking every week. The reports are made every, in fact, we had a non-government organization which took up this effort, and it was very successful. In fact, we had very excellent results, and after that, we have started transferring the technology to one company per state. So we are looking at transferring to about 20 people over a period of time, and already 4 or 5 people are interested in this technology or lined up. Similar thing we have done with the nanosilver suspension for the textile industry. The company in Bangalore was interested in developing nanosilver based antibacterial textiles. And what they wanted was really a suspension of nanosilver. And the interesting thing was, one is this fiber coated with this nano silver should last for 30 washings. That was one of the criteria. Other criteria was basically this suspension should remain as a suspension for 1 year. So they want a shelf life of 1 year. So that's both these things they had to do, and we were quite successful in that. And this is a fiber which is coated with nano silver. It also went through that criteria of 30 washes. For example, our suspension which we developed had a 99.2% retention of antibacterial activity even after 30 washes. This again has been transferred now to the company, and they are now exporting to all over the world. The suspension is being exported to all over the world, because what they do is they supply to the textile companies, who will fill it up in a tank, and then the fiber goes through by a dip route, and that gets coated with silver, and then it is woven into a fabric. Another interesting application which came to us from the industry was the surge protection. Surge protection is required not only for lightning, protection against lightning, but also in even PCs and mobile phones. We have the surge protectors, and the size depends obviously on the rating of the protection you require, and also on the material being used. And these are all usually made of zinc oxide with some dopants, which are very important because they alter the grain boundary chemistry accordingly. So, and what we have done is we have developed a zinc oxide based on nano powder, and what we found was a dramatic improvement in performance. This is the voltage current characteristics. This is the commercial one which is available. This is the one made with nano powder of zinc oxide. And in fact, we did recently with zinc oxide nano rod also, and gave even better performance. And now this is being transferred with the zinc oxide powder. And this, as you see, the performance is quite better. And for the industry, what it meant was, for the same rating, the size can be brought down by a factor of 5, or for the same size, it can perform 5 times better. And this is very, very important in especially micro applications like laptop and all that. And so there's already an industry looking at these applications, and we are in the process of transferring this technology. And we also have a facility to make large quantities of these nanopowders, including zinc oxide, LiFePO4 for the lithium-ion batteries. All this is being done. Another project which I'll briefly go through again is the aerogel project, where we are using it for two applications. One is insulating clothing, where it provides insulation especially for the army, especially when they are operating in areas like Ladakh, which is in the Himalayas. So they want an overcoat which is more insulating than the existing ones. That's what we are developing for them. Other is the insulating paint additive, where we add to the paints these nano additives which will improve the insulation, so that the air conditioning load comes down, or in the summer when the outside temperature is 43 or 44, it will at least become 36 or 35 inside without the air conditioning also. And we are also doing it for the tiles. Some of the tiles are also requiring ceramic tiles for the houses, especially for the kitchen. We are also developing something in those. The other thing which I talked about, this is a facility for Solgel nanocomposite coatings which we have set up with a company in Germany. In fact, they are pioneers in the Solgel coating technology. They felt there's a merit in combining with us and setting up a joint center. And I will not go into the facilities, large facilities we have set up. So we can do Solgel coatings on almost any substrate, plastic, metallic, ceramic, or even metal, of course. And also we can do large areas, because this facility is having large areas for that. And some of the areas applications we are looking at is, one is the stove top, because as you know, one of the major problems with the stove top is it gets dirty and it's not easy to remove the dirt, it gets sticky because of the oil and all that. So we are able to do a coating which is scratch, abrasion, tarnish and corrosion resistance is much better than the stainless steel underneath, and it's very easy to clean this stove. And in the case of handles of brass or stainless steel, we are able to give tarnish resistant coatings and also corrosion resistant coatings, so they remain as it is, the brass, once you clean it, whatever glow it had, it remains for a long time. Another interesting application for India is the fan blades, because we use a lot of fans in our houses during the weather, and the leading edges of the fans get really coated with the dirt because of a lot of dust in the room, and that dirt is again very sticky and is tough to remove, and again easy to clean is going to be very useful. And again, we're already talking with a big fan manufacturer on this technology. And there's another one is a fire retardant application, which we have developed again, where we have two glass pieces in between, put a Solgel coating, it's not really a coating, it's a very thick amount of material, and that can prevent the heat being communicated across. Even with the torch, nothing gets through. This is also another application we are looking at. And we also have set up recently an RF induction plasma synthesis facility for making nanopowders, where we can do tens of kgs of nanopowders, and we can do not only pure metals but also oxides, carbides and nitrides. As I said, electrospinning is another area where we are looking at making nanofibers using polymers, but ultimately we can even make ceramic nanofibers using this technology, because the polymer is a precursor for the ceramics ultimately. And we are looking at various applications like filters for automotive applications, solar panels, tissue engineering scaffolds and composites also. This is another process which is interesting, which is simulayer, which is much better than your planetary mill or attritor, in the sense that the kinetic energy is efficiently transferred to the powders or the particles, and because of that it scales down to nano size very, very fast compared to the other processes. And in fact, we have done number of work using this technology. One is the nano oxide dispersion strength and seal for the ITER program, which is a fusion reactor program of international program of fusion reactor, which is being set up in France, and we are developing the steel for the same. And other applications for this simulayer mechanical alloying technology is the zinc flakes for anti-corrosive paint, the aluminum powder for firecrackers, which is already very close to being transferred, and then aluminum flakes for paint application, especially for the automotive applications where they want to retain the paint quality in terms of how it looks. That also is very important. Then high performance nano cement, nano additive to cement, so that we can tailor make the period of setting that can be controlled very nicely, and the properties also can be improved. Then other thing is the cathode material for lithium ion batteries. That's another thing which we are looking at. And we also have a unique spark plasma sintering machine, which is very ideally suited for sintering nanopowders, because nanopowder nano size is retained even after sintering, and that we are using also. And we also have a PVD coating center for super hard nanocomposites, where we have a composite of silicon nitride and aluminum titanium nitride, and silicon nitride is only a few monolayers thick, and because of that the hardness can be extremely high, more than 40 GPa. That's what we get, and very stable structure, and this has very good applications for cutting tools. Cold spray coating is another technology which I will not talk much about, but the advantage of this is we can retain the nanostructure, and because of retaining the nanostructure the hardness is very quite high. So not only in copper, but also I can add alumina, which is also nano, both nano, and we get a nano composite which has a very good combination of hardness and electrical conductivity, which is important for certain applications for the spot welding electrodes. It's also another area we're looking at. And pulse electrode deposition we can also do, and we can control the grain size of the deposits right from up to 20 or even 10 nanometers grain size by altering the process control parameters. And also we can do what is called the double layer, triple layer with different hardnesses, and also even do continuous graded layer, continuously up and continuously down in terms of hardness. And so all things are possible, and this is again a technology which we are now trying to develop, and the equipment is being developed so that it can get transferred to the industry. I will not get into the details. Solution precursor plasma is another technology which we are looking at for the thermal barrier coating for the aero engine blades. This is much better than the EBPVD technology which is being currently used in terms of life. In the case of PMC, we also the polymer membrane fuel cell, of course we do the fuel cell itself, but that's not nano part of the work, but the nano part is in the catalyst. So we developed some nano tungsten carbide catalyst which give as good performance as the platinum on carbon. Then we also recently done bulk production of graphene by electrochemical method, that we are looking at various applications for that. I will not get into the details. I think we'll close with that. So that gave you an idea as to what we are doing in terms of commercialization, and what we hope is more institutions will come into this fold of commercialization, and also hope that there is a possibility for Canada and India to come together in this at the company side, so that we can have the benefit of whatever technology is developed by Canada, you know, also helps the Indian market, which is much bigger. And in the process, the Canadian company also benefits in terms of the technology fee and all that stuff. So it's all possible. So With that, I'd like to close, and I thank again Professor Kati for giving me an opportunity to talk here. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. I'm sure that if there are any questions, Dr. Sundararajan would be prepared to try and answer.
Thanks, Paul. It's a very impressive overview of the nanotech activity in India and your center. I have a couple of questions, so I will start with one. Regarding the nanosilver membranes for water filtration, from what I saw, you have kind of dead-end membranes. So how does it work, actually?
No, it's not a membrane. What you have is a cylindrical ceramic material which is porous, interconnected pores. So what happens is the water which is, so the candle is there and the water is surrounding that. Water seeps in through this whole pores continuously and gets down, then comes down at the other chamber.
Okay, and there are large pores? I mean,
yeah, they are quite large, they are quite reasonably large pores.
Okay, so you don't have any filtration by the ceramic support?
No, 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 no.
So just a catalytic. Regarding the xenoxide nanorods and the use as varistros, are they used as bulky ceramics or are they used as thin film?
What we have done is the bulky ceramics, which is used for certainly lightning arresters and some of the transformer areas where they put. But now we have to develop that as a film for especially PC applications and mobile applications. That will require that.
And if I can have at least one last question. It was the first time I saw the names Simulayer. And so it's similar to ball mills, but it's higher speed.
No, what is happening is this is a trade name. Simulayer is not a generic name, it's a trade name of that company. So what happens is in the case of arteter and ball mills, the balls obviously have a kinetic energy and they bang into each other, and hopefully the particles which we want to reduce in size comes in between and gets deformed repeatedly. Now the energy transfer to the material of our test material is very low in the case of arteter and ball mill. This guy has designed the whole thing by modeling, FEM modeling and simulation, such that the maximum kinetic energy gets transferred to the particles which we are of interest to us. And more importantly, for a given power, the kinetic energy of the balls within the whole system is much higher. So because of that, I'm able to reduce by almost a factor of 10 the time required to get the nanostructured size, grain size.
Oh, it's an optimized design?
Optimized design, yeah.
Okay. And it's because of reaction time is reduced, you lower the contamination?
Contamination is less, and also the productivity is also improving quite a bit, especially for production, yeah.
And if I may, last question. It's you talked initially about the different programs and how you support the researchers. And what type of support do you provide for the business side? I mean, you have a support for the technology upscaling. Do they get support from lawyers, from businessmen?
For support, yeah, that is, in fact, we have to work on that because that's very, very important. In fact, what happens in many of the startups, they neither have the management skills nor the financial skills. So that's where we are looking at the financial institution, and we are going to have consultants who will have one or two persons who will sort of serve all the companies as a CEO, proper sort of part-time CEO. So that's what we are going to do. Yeah, that's important, very important, I agree.
Thank you.
Very interesting talk. Could you comment on the nanopowders in terms of dispersibility when you want to formulate it into your product from a dry powder form? How do you?
Yeah, in fact, the silver I talked about was a classic case. The industry wanted that to remain in dispersion for 1 year when you keep the bottle there, you know. So I will not be able to give you the details because I'm not the scientist concerned. We have our own colleagues who have done that. But they have been able to achieve that, and that's very, very important. You see, so you have to have a proper dispersant added. You have to identify that and in proportion. And that is looks like whether we can do it in every case, I don't know. But in this case, we were very, very successful.
Yes.
Thanks for the talk. One quick question. When you do this transfer of technology to the industry, Who owns the intellectual property?
Intellectual property right is owned by the laboratory, but we license it to them on exclusive basis or non-exclusive basis. If it is on exclusive basis, we cannot transfer it to anybody else. But then we charge a higher fee in that case. Or it can be non-exclusive where we can transfer to a number of people.
The researchers who do the job actually still retain.
Yeah, right, right. Not, I mean, the intellectuals who own that, but it is all retained by the lab. Because they are all employees of the lab.
So in the grants to researchers to start spin-off companies, does the researcher have to give up the intellectual property to the funder, or is there a promise of return in terms of royalties or ownership of the company?
Most of the government funding gives the whole IP to the university or the research institution concerned. They don't take any part of it. But if the private industry funds it, obviously he'll would like to own the IP. You know, at least it should be granted to him exclusively. That much he will expect. But the individual names of the inventors will be still there in the patent.
Is that program uniquely applicable to ARCI, or is it available to Indian universities too?
Yeah, it's available to everybody, I think. What we are doing, I think, should not be possible. I think even the ISC has done something on that, I think.
What we have is, I have few patents. So the patents are owned by the institute, but the names are of the inventors. So when a commercial site comes, so that time, whatever is the fees, everything is shared in our institute in 60-40 ratio.
60 to the inventor.
60 to the inventor, 40 to the institute. So that is true for license fees, for the shares, equity, everything.
Royalty and all that.
Royalty.
So that system is there all in all the major institutions.
But that is for Indian Institute of Science, most of the IITs have the similar system. But
the smaller universities don't have. Yeah.
But defense labs will have a different system.
You're aware that at the University of Waterloo, the intellectual property belongs to the inventor.
Okay.
So, you know, if the inventor decides he wants or she wants to take it outside the institution and develop it, form a company or transfer the technology to a...
So when he takes the technology for himself to start a startup company, when a person, an inventor, decides to start his own startup company, he doesn't have to pay any fees to Waterloo.
No, unless he wants the university involved directly in helping the development.
Okay, that's different, because in our case, they have to pay some, maybe a negligible amount, depends on that, but they have to pay the, because ownership is with the institute, or the, not with the...
Institutes also pay money for the patenting costs.
Yeah, well, Waterloo would do that too if it was asked to participate in the development.
But we have no choice. No, in our case, the employer has the...
No, but I think you are unique, Waterloo, not a common one. Even universities in US, I have seen, they have to pay some license fee before they take the technology, though developed by themselves, you know.
There are other institutions in Canada that have the same policy, but they're in the minority, of course. I was going to ask you about titanium carbide and PEM fuel cells.
Tungsten carbide.
Is that a catalyst? Is it to replace platinum and ruthenium?
Yeah, right.
And it's effective?
It is quite effective. The problem is the tungsten carbide to WC to W2C ratio makes a big difference. So we are still fine-tuning that. But otherwise, it's quite effective. Especially for the oxidation side, it's okay. Reduction side, we are not really sure. So at least half of it can be replaced.
That could make a big difference.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Thank you.